now time for Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. It began as a podcast, went live on the net, and transformed into a full-blown empire. Across the web, on Fight Now TV, and on radio stations around the world. It's the only daily boxing talk radio show on the planet, hosted by the only guy with the balls to do it. Many have stepped into the ring. Many have tried to take the belt. And one by one, they've fallen. Another victim of the undisputed heavyweight champion of boxing talk radio. Talkin' Boxing with Billy C is on now.
My style is impetuous, my defense is impregnable, and I'm just ferocious. I want your heart.
And we're coming to you live.
Live!
From the Billy C studio in Lake George, New York. I'm Bill Caligiuri. It's time for Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. Good morning, good day, good evening. Whenever you listen, hope you're doing all right. Don't forget, if you're checking us out live, go visit www.ldltv.com for our enhanced version of the show. And we're getting a pretty good handle on that. So when we do all our new shows next week, which will be a full slate every single night after this show, they'll only be available on LDLTV. So get used to going over there. This show is being brought to you in part by Camp and Aaron Tomkovich. If you're looking for a lawyer, use the ones that keep my ass out of trouble. That's Camp and Aaron Tomkovich. Give them a call today, 845-221-4099, 845-221-4099. Let Camp and Aaron Tomkovich knock out your legal problem. And the show is also being brought to you in part by the Turning Stone Resort and Casino in Verona, New York, and the big Friday night fight that they're having on Showtime. That's right, tomorrow night. When's Friday, man? When's Friday? I'm going to be there. I want you to be there, too. Get yourself some tickets. Visit our website, www.billycboxing.com. And click the fight poster, which is right there on the right-hand side. It says Turning Stone. It says Showtime. It says Click Me. No, I don't know if it says that. But click them. Click it anyway. Get yourself some tickets. Drop me an email, Billy at TalkinBoxing, TalkinBoxing.com. And let me know where you're sitting. I'll make every effort to come on and see you. Alex and I are going to be ringside. Looking forward to that. Especially if you're going to be up at the Hall of Fame. You can find me at the old Carmen Basilio Sausage and Pepper tent. Stuffing my fat ass tomorrow around 11 o'clock. I think the sausages will be ready about that. I'm gonna be up there then. But anyway, check that out. I think I got to call Camp and Aaron Tomkovich. I wonder if they handle animal abuse cases, because I think I might have to abuse a couple of deer. You know, I mean, I love the natural world here where I live, and. You know, I like watching the deer. Yeah, they crap all over the lawn and stuff like that. But, you know, today I'm wondering, I got these, they're not bushes, all right? But it's like, I call them mini woods, you know, it like separates looking at a neighbor's house, you know. I mean, I got woods all around me. But I was always wondering what the hell, why this row of these bushes, you know, were always like not healthy looking, you know. I was wondering what was up. Well, I found out today, you know, it's like a buffet for the deer. You know, my bushes are a buffet for the deer. You know, they're all lined up like they. I was wondering to see if there's any trays that they were getting trays. And, you know, of course they're eating, crapping, and oh man, you know. And I'm looking at them, and all of a sudden I thought the clouds came in. It was like a pterodactyl or something flew over the yard. I don't know what the hell it was. It was the biggest bird I've ever seen in my life. I'm like, what the hell was that? You know. I was waiting to hear an engine or something. It was some kind of bird. But anyway, we got a lot of stuff coming up in a little bit. I got some news out of HBO Boxing Central. Man, you know, a lot of misfortune. You know, I only thought it happened to me, but HBO's maybe what did they steal my identity or something? Maybe they're getting a lot of bad luck happening to them. But I'll be telling you about that in a little bit. My man, I love this kid, Silva. Remember the guy that was fighting That fought Alfredo Angulo, Jorge Pantera Silva, and well, he's back in the news. He's making some comments about Angulo. I love this, man. You know, Angulo's like this, you know, cage. Everybody's referring to, he's this caged lion. You know, he's this, he's that. And this guy, Silva, wait till I tell you what he's saying now. They got a couple of European fights we're going to talk about. An update on Saul Canelo Alvarez and some of things going on with him. We also have Eddie Hearn, a promoter, what he's got in store for Kessler, what he's got in store for Frotch, being either Kessler or Ward. We'll be talking about that. I'm going to be breaking down the fights a little bit later on in the show. We got 12 fights that are part of the Billy C Challenge today, this weekend. So I'll be breaking those fights down, giving you my predictions. And Daxx Kahn, yeah, that's right. Daxx Kahn is going to be joining us a little bit later, and we'll be chatting with him as well. But first, we got some emails. And I was choked on this guy. You know, and he's down. What's he doing? I think he just had a heart attack. But anyway, Hawk Mustang, my man, he says, I want to know if Andy's little bet he's got going on here in the chat room, if it means me or the listeners, because, you know, it's not fair that I'm being held responsible for subjects that you guys bring up and, you know, I comment on. So, you know, I don't think Andy's being fair. But anyway, Hawk says, boxing is becoming a woman's sport. I'm tired of boxers crying that they think a scary man is on roids. If I ran from every scary guy and every guy that was bigger than me, I could have used the PED excuse to run from everyone I ever got into a fight with. He says, and I was no boxing champ. I only fought some bullies. He says, to hear boxing champions cry like babies makes me sad. I don't want to hear these clowns hiding behind PED excuses. If you're not a fighter, go bake cupcakes and STFU. You know what that means. Even I know what that means. Shut the, you know, up, you know. But anyway, he says, now I'm not gonna use the word he uses for Mayweather, but it rhymes with May, and it's got a G in there, and it's followed by the word runner. And he says, started all this PED catchweight excuses just because he didn't want a third world Southpaw midget Asian to. Yeah, I think, what did Hawk drink? What I drank? I mean, come on, man. You know, he sounded like me in there, you know. He says, this third world Southpaw midget Asian to molly whoop his stupid ass all over the ring. He says, Mayweather saw how Pacquiao handled my boy Oscar De La Hoya. Now, this is Hawk Mustang saying this. And Floyd Mayweather got really shook. He says Floyd was more shook than Garcia is right now, having to face Matisse. Floyd and his fans, I'll just use that choice of words, talked all this catch weight draining BS. Now they're all hypocrites. They all flip-flop. Make boxing fair and PEDs legal. He says also make rabbit punches legal if they're not in a clinch. Hey, Hawk, maybe they should carry guns and knives in the ring too, man. I mean, maybe we should have guys, you know, toss them down into the lions and see who comes out alive. But only kidding. I understand his frustration. And, you know, it's funny that you say this, Hawk, because, you know, I said this when Alex was on the PED, when the big story got broken several months ago by Montoya, Gabe Montoya, you know, and then he quieted up right away. You know, that was something that I had said, you know, and baseball, I mean, if you follow other sports, you know what's going on right now with baseball and performance-enhancing drugs. And, you know, it comes to a point where, you know, if these guys are going to cheat, you know, if you have some guys that are saying that they're not going to use performance-enhancing drugs and then they cheat and they try to use them, you know, they're cheating. You know, if you made them legal and you said, "Hey, listen, this is entertainment. You wanna ruin yourself. You wanna shorten your lifespan. You wanna have muscles on your eyelids. Well, then knock yourself out. Because I don't care. I want to see, people knock each other into the third row. I want to see home runs that fly out of the stadium and land into the ocean surrounding the stadium. That's what I want to see. And as crazy as it sounds, it's almost like, you know what? Would that eliminate the problem? Would they find something else to cheat with? Back in the day, you look at baseball. What'd they do? They had a little bit of sandpaper under their hat. Maybe a little Vaseline. Get the ball, do some crazy things in boxing. So they threw a horseshoe in the ring. In their glove. So they put a little concrete on the hand wraps. Give them a little edge. Now we got performance enhancing drugs. Some guys say they use it. Some are not. Then they get caught when they use it. They lose, and everybody says, "See, they said the same thing with Antonio Margarito. See, he was nothing. He lost. He didn't have the cement in his glove, so he can't win." I don't know, man. It's like this. What are we looking for? Is it entertainment? Do we care? Are we hiding behind it like Hawk suggests? Are fighters just using it as an excuse? The catchweight thing is total BS. There should be no such thing as catchweights. Catchweight is nothing but a crock of BS. No, the bottom line is this. You want to fight somebody and you're challenging him and he's in it or she's in a different weight class than you, then you go to that weight class. As long as you don't exceed the weight and as long as you don't come in under the weight more than the commissions allow, which incidentally, I'm not so sure I'm for that rule either. That's supposed to protect the fighter. I'm not so sure it does. Back in the day, you hear us talking about the old-time fighters all the time, and the bottom line is this, if a middleweight wanted to challenge a heavyweight, they said, go ahead, knock yourself out. You want to weigh at 170 for the fight and the heavyweight's going to weigh 200? Good. God bless you. Good luck, man. Today, you could do a fight. You can have a fight at middleweight, maximum of 160, and one guy comes in, he weighs 160. The other guy comes in, he weighs 153, and they say, "Whoops, sorry, 7-pound swing, man. Can't do it. Can't do it. Our rules say 6 pounds max, or some other rules might say 7. Some may say 4. I don't know. Every commission's a little different. I don't know. I mean, catch weights are BS. I'm not so sure about the legalizing PEDs. But the bottom line is Hawk's point is simply this. If you're going to do it, do it. Let it be legal for everybody. If you're a cheater, you're going to find a way. If performance-enhancing drugs were legal, if these guys could put the ointment on, shoot themselves up, chew down a candy that's going to give them some super home run power or knockout power, whatever, or do whatever Marquez did. Whatever the case is, if they want to do it, and as long as everybody else can do it, it evens the playing field, right? Well, until somebody finds something else to do to cheat. Because trust me, they will. They will. I got to take a break. We'll be right back.
If you're in upstate New York and you need a trucking company, then you need Roselli Enterprises. Roselli Enterprises is trucking at its finest. They have it all. Dump trucks, dump trailers, walk-in floors, flatbeds, flow boys, tankers, loaders, and a full line of roll-off containers for any job, big or small. Roselli Enterprises is also the source for all your sand, gravel, and topsoil needs. Visit them on the web at RoselliTrucking.com or call 315-433-5115. That's 315-433-5115 and tell them Billy C sent you.
Are you ready, America? Then let's get it on with Fight Now TV. It's time, fight fans. Your channel has arrived. All the fights, all the names, all the action. From world-class boxing events to mixed martial arts showdowns and other combat sports matchups, Fight Now TV delivers the hits and more. Call your television provider and tell them you want to get it on with Fight Now TV. For more details, go to fightnow.com.
We've got a great matchup tonight. Fighting out of the left corner is the number one ranked contender.
No, he is not.
I'm sorry, but who are you?
I am the IBO computer. I am programmed to provide only fair and unbiased boxing rankings. This fighter is the number 15 ranked contender.
Fair and unbiased boxing rankings? That's a new concept.
Actually, it is not. The IBO has provided unbiased computerized rankings for many years.
Well, we've still got a great fight tonight, folks. In the left corner is the number 15 ranked contender.
The IBO, the champion of integrity. Learn more at IBOboxing.com.
Check out BillyCBoxing.com now. or feel the wrath of the mighty mustache.
Oh, that hurts! Why are you doing that to my face?
We're back.
As a young boy, all Billy C dreamed about was one day having his own catchphrase.
And we're back.
One boy, one dream, one day, everyone will say.
And we're back.
Catchphrase, coming soon to a theater near you.
And we're back. You're listening to the Talking Box with Billy C Show. Glad you could join us. Hey, by the way, if you're watching us live right now through an internet feed, check out www.LDLTV.com. Got some enhanced stuff. We've been playing around with some new toys. Not those kind of toys, Daxx. Come on, man. But the bottom line is, starting next week when we do all the shows that we announced and we played around yesterday with the heavyweight spotlight, then they're all going to be on LDLTV in enhanced mode, as long as the as long as the production crew puts down the alcohol and stops well, the women, in South Florida, there's so many hot women around they can't even pay attention. You know, my neck would be hurting. You know, I'd be looking over there, looking over there. Anyway, Justin Griffin says, don't be shocked if Darly Perez upsets Yuriorkis Gamboa, especially if he's overlooking Perez. If Perez has any power, we could see a close decision because of Gamboa's suspect chin and tendency for him getting knocked down. Either way, I think it's going to be a great fight. He says, as far as that's concerned, I mean, listen, anytime Gamboa gets in the ring, when he tries to change his style that he's so accustomed to doing, which means don't go all out and just use your hand speed and everything else, when he tries to box, he thinks too much, and that's when he gets dropped. His chin is suspect because he hits the deck, but in those 7-8 times he's found the canvas under his butt, he's never been hurt. I've never seen him really hurt. One thing that I do agree with you, Justin, is that Gamboa is technically moving up in weight to fight Perez. Perez is young, but Gamboa is, I happen to love Gamboa, but I do believe that he's one of these guys that, his career is going to end quickly. And I'm not so sure. I think he's good that he's with 50 Cent right now. But I don't think 50 knows the business well enough yet to do more for the fighters than the fighters can do for him, if you know what I mean. In other words, Gamboa's got a name, he's got a following, and for 50 to associate himself with Gamboa is good. But I'm not so sure that it's the other way around. You know, if I'm working with Gamboa, I'm picking and choosing the fighters that he's in. As he moves up, he should be moving up in weight a little more carefully, a little more intelligently. Just moving up in weight one class in one fight, then moving up another one and taking on guys, you know, young bucks. We like to call them young bucks, like a Darly Perez. I don't know. I think Justin has a good point. He says, Billy C, you were referring to Abreu. That's right. Carlos Abreu, when he fought Timothy Bradley, that was Bradley's first welterweight fight. He was trying to knock him out with that one punch. And I believe that's the only loss that Abreu has. I think he's done well since then. I appreciate that, Justin. Thanks. I had a brain lapse yesterday. I couldn't think of Abreu's name. He says, and one more thing. I agree that Marlon Starling should be in the Hall of Fame. He was the first person to defeat Mark Breland, and I thought he got robbed in a rematch, even though he was given a draw. He says he stopped Lloyd Hunnigan for the WBC title, who at the time was considered a top welterweight from Great Britain, who stopped Donald Curry in a huge upset. That was one of the most shocking fights I think I've ever seen I was a big Donald Curry fan, and when Lloyd Hunnigan beat him, that was pretty much the end of Donald Curry. Listen, you could argue that Marlon Starling really only lost one fight in his career. I believe, as my memory recall, if my memory serves me well, he's got six losses on his record. Every single one of those losses were split decisions, majority decisions, or in the case of a couple of draws, he was robbed blatantly. There was really only one fight that he admits losing. I agree with him, you know, and he was an extremely, extremely talented defensive fighter. There's no question about that. I know Given Quality should mute his computer right now, but he was a lot like You-Know-Who. Did not have the athleticism of You-Know-Who, and did not have the hand speed, but certainly had the defense, and was willing to mix it up. And you know, yes, I'm a little biased for Marlon because he's a buddy of mine, but the guy is the real deal. If you've never seen him fight, go check out some of his fights. They're very easy to get. Thanks for the email, Justin. Keep them up. Biggerback says, am I the only one who thinks that the fans are benefiting from the rival networks going head-to-head? Now I will see more quality fights, even if it weren't live, it's still better for me. He says, I feel that there's going to be a big upset this Saturday, many live underdogs fight, and hopefully you're going to talk more about the fights happening next Saturday more than the ones happening in September. By the way, I noticed that you look more alive and enthused at nights. Well, you know, it does help a little bit, bigger back, when you can get up, you know, late in the morning, like 5, instead of me getting up at 2. So, yeah. But listen, man, I said that a long time ago. I'm surprised you don't recall me saying that, that I think that in the long run, it's definitely better that we have this rivalry going on. And as much as I can't stand division in the sport, I think that the rivalry between the networks and now all of a sudden it's kind of associating with the promoters as well equals that, you know, the competition level. You know, we got to put on a good fight. We got to put an entertaining fight on. And then the other networks says, well, we got to put a better one on, you know, and they turn to the promoters. And maybe that's an indication of why HBO just lost one of their longtime boxing people for 14 years. So, yeah, I agree with Biggerback a lot. I also agree with, you know, I think nothing for nothing, but I think a lot of the fans, a lot of you guys that watch and listen to this show need to start thinking about these other fights that we do have. And Biggerback is 100%, hey, Porky, he's 100% correct that there are a lot of good fights coming up, and we got 12 that I'm going to be talking about in a little bit. 12, actually, every fight on the slate this week is pretty tough to pick. I mean, you could have a case for every single opponent fighting each other. You could, you know, argue the case for either side. Listen, the big fight in September, we got plenty of time to talk about it. I just hope that you guys don't keep talking about it between now and then. We just can't dissect it anymore. You know, I mean, it's okay because it was just announced, and you know, I'm all for that. But hopefully, we can turn the tide Monday. You know, let's have our goal for Monday, turn the tide, unless, you know, something is newsworthy. One more email before I take a break. My man Alex T was watching the enhanced version, and he says, I love that girl that's saying that. Hey, listen, he says, Lori Dawn something or other, I think. Hey, listen, time out. Lori Dawn Langdon, that's who it is, and she's mine, okay? This is my dream girl. I've been going after this girl for a long time. She has no time for me, all right? And now you're making a play on her, Alex T? Come on, man. Come on, just slow it down, man. Slow it down. And then he goes on to say the real body of the email. He says, I want to tell you what, man. He says, whatever you do, to keep from flipping out when your system doesn't work properly, I want to know what it is, because I could use some of that patience around my kids. Like when they get out of bed 50 times at night to go to the bathroom, for example. Or when I go to use the bathroom after working an 11-hour day and somebody conveniently just decided to take a leak all over the floor instead of the toilet. You know, the joys of young boys. He says, people say to me all the time, oh, you're lucky. Girls are much harder than boys. He says, really? I want to know, but I'm guessing they don't pee on your walls. First of all, you want to help the kids. I mean, maybe what you should do is try beating the hell out of those damn kids with a newspaper. Stick their nose in that pee if they're peeing on the floor. You know, I don't know, man. Maybe consider paper training your kids, man. I don't know. But that's got to be tough. You know, I had two girls, and no, they never peed on the floor or the walls. But let me tell you about that. When I tell you that I am not a patient guy and that I fly off the handle and that, you know, it shocks me that I can keep my composure when stuff like that goes. Last night, and you could ask John from LDLTV, last night it almost happened on the second show. We started having some issues with one piece of equipment, and we had no problems for 2 hours with this show. And Tony Treem and I started trying to talk, and it sounded like, well, if you played the show, if you played the heavyweight spot, you'll know what I mean. So, listen, I don't know. I can't explain why or how the hell I'm able to do that. I think that, to be honest with you, I just think that my mindset is professionalism 100%. You know, no disrespect to someone that does, you know, boxing type shows as a hobby. I know I've been negative about that. And I don't mean it negative in a way of them doing something they enjoy. What I mean negatively is when someone tries to compare that with what we do, because we try to stay on a total professional plane. You know, I try not to, you know, use foul language, even though I could if I wanted. We're on cable and internet. I can't for the radio. I have been warned by by the radio people. But, you know, I try to keep it professional. And I think that's the only secret. But for the kids peeing on the floor, I would try sticking their nose in it. Maybe that would work.
Are you ready, America? Then let's get it on with Fight Now TV. It's time, fight fans. Your channel has arrived. All the fights, all the names, all the action. From world-class boxing events to mixed martial arts showdowns and other combat sports matchups, Fight Now TV delivers the hits and more. Call your television provider and tell them you want to get it on with Fight Now TV. For more details, go to fightnow.com.
Billy C, you don't call anymore. You don't stalk me. I mean, I appreciate the occasional shout out, but I lie in my bed shouting your name out all the time. Nothing. I don't know what happened. We were so close. And everybody likes to watch Billy C talking about boxing on LDLTV, but you don't give me the love you used to. I need more shout outs, Billy C, man. Give me some freaking love. Get myself all worked up just thinking about you and that mustache. It's delicious. You're watching Talking Boxing with Billy C and his mighty mustache on LDLTV. It's delicious.
www.kofantasyboxing.com. Select your own gym, your own fighters, track them through a season that can last from 3 months to a year, depending upon which league you join. You got to check this out, man. www.kofantasyboxing.com. Join it today. Again, www.kofantasyboxing.com. And tell them Billy C sent ya.
Now back to Talkin' Boxing with Billy C, the only radio host man enough to take a punch from Mike Tyson.
Wait a minute, man. Hold on there. Jeremy, man, I need you to take this one, all right?
Wait, what? No way. I can't do this.
Need I remind you I'm Billy C, damn it? Now put on that mustache.
Hi, I'm Holden Pawnee's former NBA player, and you're watching Talking Boxing on LDLTV with my man, Billy C.
The undisputed heavyweight champion of boxing talk radio. It's Talking Boxing with Billy C.
Test 1, 2. My fellow Americans, good evening. Welcome back to Talking Boxing with Billy C. It's great to be here discussing the sweet science with everybody. I love boxing. I love talking boxing. It's what I do.
Bill.
Wait, what? Why are you interrupting me?
Wrong.
What's
wrong,
the problem?
Billy what? C.
I did not have...
We're going to have to ask
wrong
you
speech. What do you mean wrong, Billy C? What's going on here? Fine, I'll go. I just wanted to talk some boxing on TPS radio. That's all I wanted to do. I don't need your damn show. I'll get my own talking wrestling with the other Billy C. Yeah, that sounds good. Yeah. I've always been a Hulkamaniac anyway.
Our guest in live, brother. Welcome back to Talking Boxing with Billy C on the mighty TPSradio.net, brother. What you gonna do, brother?
Thanks, Hulk. You're listening to the Talking Boxing with Billy C show. You're watching us on the Fight Now television channel. Glad you could join us. Got some happening stuff. If you're watching live on any place that you may be watching us live, check out our chat room right at BillyCBoxing.com and see what's going on in there. You might find it amusing. Give a shout out to my main man, JJ. He's working the boards in South Florida. Yeah, he's working the broads in South Florida, you know. I know his pops got him chained to the chair working the boards, but as soon as he's done with working the boards, he's gonna be working them broads. Yeah, he's lucky, man, living in South Florida. You know, I was thinking, you know, maybe as an alternative for Alex T to, you know, beat the hell out of his kids for peeing on the floor, maybe he should try one of those housebreaking wee wee pads. Did you ever hear that when you buy a puppy? And you get a free housebreaking wee-wee pad with every puppy you buy. You know, what the hell's a wee-wee pad? You know, I want the dog to pee outside, man. I don't want him peeing on a wee-wee pad, you know? You know, wee-wee pad, you know, that means they're just peeing someplace they get used to peeing on. You know, you put the wee-wee pad in your pocket. Next thing you know, they're lifting their leg and pissing all over you. I don't know, man. My man Dan the Man Henderson. He's our very own TMZ kind of guy on the streets of London. So anybody that's in London right now, you know, just be careful. Be careful. My man Dan might be, he may be watching you. Uh-huh. He says, Team Furrier definitely in talks with Adam Booth. He says, the bottom line is, this is for the fight between David Haye and Tyson Fury. It's going to be in September. He says, in my opinion, this is going to be a great fight, and I believe that it's a 50-50 fight, depending on which Fury shows up. If it's the Fury that fought Kevin Johnson, then I could see him frustrating Haye and winning via unanimous decision. But if he turns up angry and tries to slug it out with David Haye, then David Haye is going to win the fight because he definitely has the power to knock him out. I agree with you, man. I agree with you. You know, the thing about Tyson Fury is he's got, listen, he doesn't have the athleticism of a Klitschko, but he's got a 9,000-inch reach, you know, and he's got a pretty stiff jab, and, you know, if he's conditioned and can move a little with those Herman Munster feeties of his, you know, I mean, the bottom line is this. He could jab the hell out of David Haye all night long. David Haye doesn't have the you-know-whats to go in. You know, he'll dart in and try and land a shot and get out. And I think he's hittable. I think Tyson Fury's hittable. So it's going to be a tough fight. I don't care which Tyson Fury shows up. He says Fury must box cleverly and drag, what, Nathan? No, he meant clever. He should box him cleverly. He should box him cleverly, then drag Haye into the second half of the fight because Haye begins to gas out around 6 or 7 rounds. Whatever the outcome, it'll be a great fight. With an even better build-up because both guys like to talk trash, and I'm sure this will be the tactic Haye deploys. He will and try and get Tyson so worked up that come fight night, all Tyson will want to do is engage in a fight, which will play into David Haye's hands. I agree with you. I think not only will they do that, but they will also push and shove each other a lot at all the press conferences. I also predict that you'll eventually see one of those cages or bulletproof you know, plexiglass things put in between them. It's all part of the game, and that's what makes me sick about that kind of you know, pre-fight stuff, because it's all an act. You know, because these guys, the first thing they're gonna do is you know, hug each other after the fight. You know, so anyway, I mean, listen, I think it's a tough fight for Tyson Fury, to be honest with you, but I'll be hoping that he beats David. But anyway, my man Bjorn Henrique says, I think the fact that Floyd reached out to Pacquiao directly actually made Bob Arum more infuriated and put the nail in the coffin of that fight, because Floyd essentially tried to cut Arum out of the deal. You know, I don't even know about that. I'm not going to comment on it, really, because, you know, if you listen to Floyd, that's what Floyd said. You know, Pacquiao, I guess Pacquiao did admit that Floyd called him, and he said he wanted a 50-50 split. Listen, the big issue was this. Floyd should give two craps about what Manny makes. He should worry about himself. You know, if he gets a 60-40 split or whatever the split was, you know, it doesn't matter that Manny is only going to get a percentage of that. You know, that's not, you know, Floyd to worry about, at least in my opinion. But anyway, that's that. And, you know, I don't know. Manny Pacquiao's got other things to worry about, and so does Floyd at this point. But I think it definitely irked Bob Arum. I agree with Bjorn there. We got another. Actually, I'm looking at this, and he got another email from Dan the Man Henderson. I didn't realize this one was here. He says, "I know you don't want to talk about Mayweather and Alvarez. I don't. I am kind of sick of that fight already." He says, "But I've heard a lot of." But I've not heard of any stipulations in the contract for if Canelo comes in overweight. So I was thinking, if I were Canelo, I'd just come in at 154, because what's the worst thing that can happen? He may have to pay a few dollars, or at the worst case, Mayweather could say he's not fighting, which would make him look really bad. What do you think? I think you got a good point. I think you got a good point. Floyd wouldn't be able to complain, because that's exactly what he did to Juan Manuel Marquez. And, yeah, he would get fined. And you're right, I haven't heard of any overweight clauses. And, you know, I think that whole catchweight thing is BS. Can't stand catchweights. Can't stand it. Can't stand it. Can't stand it. You know, the fight, as soon as it went to 148, it became junior middleweight. You know, once they decided that the weight was going to be over 147 pounds, it's a junior middleweight fight. That means 154 is the max. You know, and they're fighting more towards junior middle than anything anyway. So not a bad approach, really, if you're Canelo, because you'd be catching a Floyd in a situation where he would not really have much to say about that. That's for sure. But anyway, you know, it's funny, given quality saying, he's always saying, oh, Floyd never weighs 150. Floyd, I just read an article that Floyd said, you know, I walk around at between 160 and 163, but fight night, I like to be down. He said he says he walks around at 160, you know, so. Alex T, another one from Alex T, says, it's always going to, and this is about Vic Darchinyan and Nonito Donaire, he says, it's always going to be a bad fight for Vic. And I love Vic. I think he's arguably the most underrated fighter of the last 10 years. I don't know if he's underrated, bro. I think he's exciting, and I think that he's fought a lot of exciting fights and stuff. I don't think he's underrated. I think he gets the props. And in some cases, I think he might even be a tad overrated, his skill set. I love listening to him talk. I love how he just takes, I'm going to rip his head off. You know, that's what I'm going to do. You know, but anyway, he says he comes to fight right at you, right? And then he says, and Donaire throws straight hand, straight hard knockout punches. He will knock out Vic every time they fight. Listen, I told everybody that I wasn't fully sold on Nonito Donaire. I'm sorry, I'm not. You know, with the exception of his last fight, you know, that was really the first time where he fought a guy his own size. you know, and a guy that had some talent. You know, I think Nonito Donaire, he reminds me of a spoiled brat kid is what he reminds me of. You know, and I think that's exactly what he is, to tell you the truth. You know, he's got more excuses than, you know, I've ever heard. You know, he keeps coming up with excuses. He's probably still writing down excuses for the next line of excuses that he's going to have. I don't know. He says, the news about Eric Morales makes me sick. I read on one website where a writer noted that the trash talk between Soto and Morales and said, looks like fans may be in for a good one. He says, no. The only thing fans are in for is seeing one of the greatest Mexican fighters of all time walking around in 10 years with brain damage. And shame on Socha for calling out an old man who's about a decade past his prime. Maybe he can call out Azuma Nelson next. I understand your frustration with that, Alex. But the truth of the matter is there? I think they're the same age. If I'm not mistaken, I think Soto might even be older than Morales. Morales has been in some tough fights, and I fully agree with you that his time has come and gone. But you got to give New York a pat on the back. You know, New York State Athletic Commission, remember, he failed not one, not two, but three performance-enhancing drug tests, and New York said, go ahead, you can fight. Alex is about Elmer Ray. He says, man, oh, man. He says, I'm looking at Elmer Ray's record online right now. He said, this is amazing. This guy literally faced a murderer's row of fighters right out of the gate when he turned pro. We're talking guys with 30 wins, 50 wins, 60 wins, 90 wins. These are guys he faced when he turned pro in 1935. John Henry Lewis and Jersey Joe Walcock, to name a few. B.J. Flores would crap in his pants and have nightmares for years if he ever saw Elmer Ray's competition. He says, and he lost a lot of these fights. Then you flash forward to 1943, and he seems to have come into his own where he wasn't losing anymore, and he was going on a tear with wins over guys like Jersey Joe Walcott, Ezra Charles, etc. And he says, and like you said, almost all of his wins were by knockout. Honestly, Bill, this is why I listen to your show. Yeah, I watch all the current fights, too, and have opinions. But I'll leave it up to someone else to talk about what kind of socks you-know-who likes to wear or whatever people are talking about now. But guys like Elmer Ray blow my mind. He says, how did he get it? How come he never got a title shot? How come I have not heard of him before your show? Well, I tell you why he didn't get a title shot is because he was in line for a title shot, actually, and then lost. I believe he lost to Ezra Charles. If it wasn't Ezra Charles, it was another fight with Jersey Joe, and that ended his title hopes. He was a number one contender or number two or something like that, and one more fight would have catapulted him in, and he lost that fight. And back then, remember something, and this is something that you got to put in perspective. There were 10 world ranked contenders. For 8 weight divisions, by the way. So there's 10. So, you know, when you got ranked at number 10, you know, you were a damn good fighter. You know, if a fighter was on a card and the card said, you know, fighting tonight in the main event in a middleweight fight, we got a number 10 ranked contender, you know, Vinny Gumbats. That was as valuable, more to me, it's more valuable than a silver belt, you know. I mean, you know, number 10 meant you were the 10th best fighter in the world. Now you can laugh at that and say, yeah, so what? There's a million 10. No, there's not. The way it's broken down today, the alliances with fighters and sanctioning body, the WBC number 10 guy is not the same number 10 guy as the WBA. So if you count, you know, 5 major sanctioning bodies, you could conceivably have 50 top 10 contenders. 50. You know, so in Elmer Ray's day, you had 10. So when you fought your way up and you earned that shot where you became a mandatory or you worked your way into that number 2 position, one more fight gets you number 1, and then the number 1 guy fought the champion, that was a big deal. When you lost that fight, man, you got back. It was like playing King of the Mountain. You know, you were back down at the bottom, and you had to make that climb up again. So, you know, being ranked back in the day meant something a lot more than it does today. And let me tell you another thing. You would have never seen, you would have never opened up the Ring magazine when it was worth something and looked at the rankings and all of a sudden say, who's this guy at number 8? I never heard of this guy. No way in hell would you have ever said that, because you would have heard the guy. The guy would have fought 30 or 40 times before he was even ranked in the top 10. Now you all of a sudden you see the rankings come out. You see a fight that gets announced by a so-called champion. Oh, he's fighting the number 8 guy. And you're like, I never heard of this guy. He's number 8. And sure enough, you go look at the rankings and he mysteriously appeared at number 8. And oh, by the way, he's undefeated too. You know, you're like, oh, where did he come from? But that's a big difference of that era. Anyway, he says, Elmer Ray, young Stribling, two fighters who I only found out about listening to the Talking Boxing with Billy C show. We can't let people forget about these guys. This is amazing history right there. You're right, Alex T. I appreciate it. I'm glad you gave me the opportunity to talk about that, because that's actually a very important piece of this show. And it's one of the reasons why I do this show. But anyway, I appreciate that. And for anybody that is listening live right now or watching live, don't forget you can check out a different version of the show on LDLTV.com, or you can check it out also on BillyCBoxing.com. So check that out. It was announced today that HBO Sports Senior VP Kerry Davis is leaving the company. He's been involved with HBO for 14 years. As the fight buyer, this is huge news, man. And it's not getting the press that it should. And that's why I want to talk about it. You know, we all know, and actually Bigger Back was mentioning earlier, and we've talked about this. You know, this war, this feud that's going on now between, you know, not only the promoters, but now the networks as well. And yes, I do believe that that it's going to be better for us in the long run. But there's been some weird moves over the last couple of years, if you think about it. Now, Kenny Hirschman was one of the first major moves. Ken Hirschman was the guy who really, in my opinion, put Showtime on the map in terms of competing with HBO. As a matter of fact, how many times did we say on this show that you know, Showtime was putting on better events? Then Kenny Hirschman left, and he took the job with HBO. HBO's guy left, and Kenny Hirschman went over to HBO. And I thought it would be good. And, you know, the way the cable networks work and the way they work with specifically boxing, you know, TV dates, you know, the misconception, and I know that most of you guys are and gals are very well-versed in the sport of boxing, and you know the deal. But in case you don't, you know, the thing is this, in boxing, in the sport of boxing, TV dates are picked a year in advance. You know, there may be some last minute swings. There may be some bouts that get changed the week of the fight and stuff. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the date. I'm talking about the promoter who secures the date, the network who gets the date, the venue, all that stuff. It's done. It's picked. The network say, we're going to do X amount of shows this year. You know, now let's see who we're going to do them with. Who's going to be the promoter? Now, you know, when Kenny Hirschman left Showtime, it took him almost a full year before I started noticing his blueprint that made Showtime good to start to come on HBO. Then you had that other little wrench that was thrown into the mix. You know, the one when he came out and, you know, he was mad at Golden Boy because of the alliance that they clearly showed and says, we ain't doing no business with you no more. And then that set, you know, a whole bunch of stuff going on. So, but in the long run, I think it's going to be good. I'm not so sure about this move. I'm not so sure if this is good or bad. Now, this could be good. And my initial reaction is it's good. Because one of my hang-ups with HBO is that, for the most part, we don't see competitive fights on HBO. We used to see more competitive fights on Showtime. That's kind of changing. You know, if you think about Showtime, and before you say it, because we've been, you know, kind of, you know, programmed into knowing that Showtime, you know, was putting out some good stuff. You know, if that's in the back of your mind and you say, well, Showtime, you know, they put on more competitive fights. If before those words flow off your lips, and you start to think about the last, you know, couple of months worth of fights on Showtime, you know, you could find some blowouts, man. You could find some pretty much mismatched fights. I think Showtime shows losing Ken Hirschman more than HBO deciding not to deal with Golden Boy and you know, this slow, methodical rebuilding. So maybe Kerry Davis leaving is an indication that, you know, we're going to get better fights, that the criteria for a fight on HBO might be a little better. I don't know Kerry Davis. I know he's been with HBO for 14 years buying fights. So, you know, that off the bat might say, well, you know, the guy must be a boxing guy if he's been doing it for 14 years. Not so. Not necessarily. Because the bottom line is that could be his job. But he could have hated his job, you know. He could say, listen, this guy looks good. He's undefeated. That guy looks good. You know, Showtime, I look at Showtime right now, and I see some things that have basically went down the toilet. Number one, you know, and I think Al Bernstein is you know, the best, you know, boxing commentator the sport has had in a long time. But even his game is down. And the whole announcing team. Now, Paulie, you guys know my opinion about Paulie. I think he's very knowledgeable. Not fighting. I'm talking about commentating. He's very knowledgeable, and I like what he says. He comes right on. I just don't like the Fran Drescher sound. I don't like that annoying voice. His voice annoys me as much as his little mosquito-like punches. You know, and I can't take it. But I would take Paulie Malignaggi and Al Bernstein any day of the week, but not that other guy. Listen, I was very critical of what's his name, the guy that went from MMA to somebody help me here in the chat room. What was Gus Johnson? I just remembered Gus Johnson. You know, when he first came to Showtime, he was yelling and screaming. I remember coming on that Monday going, what the F is going on? This guy yelling and screaming. I get yelled at enough. I don't need to be yelled at while I'm trying to watch a boxing match, you know? And I mean, all he did was yell and scream, you know? And you know, we really beat him up pretty bad. And then, you know, he started cooling it out. He started doing a good job. I actually thought one of the last broadcasts that Gus Johnson did, he wasn't that bad. You know, he really wasn't. And then they get rid of him and they replace him with Mario Ranallo or whatever, however you say his name. No disrespect to Canadians or anything, but he's from Canada and he's got this Canadian way, but he's yelling at you in the Canadian way. And Canadians usually don't yell. You know, every Canadian I know, you know, has got a good, except for one, has got a good personality and they're friendly and you know, everything else. And I've never heard them yell, you know, and this guy is yelling and screaming. He cuts off Al. Al sits there, and I've never heard Al not say much. And when he does say something, he's off his game. I think this guy is ruining the broadcast, and I have no idea how they would put this guy in place. Barry Tompkins and Steve Farhood, they both do a great job together on Showtime. Why not move Barry Tompkins to that slot? And nothing for nothing, why not? If you got a problem with Barry Tompkins for some reason, you don't want him on the Showtime one, what's wrong with Al taking the lead role, man? You know, I mean, you don't need Mario Ranallo or whatever his name is. You don't need him. You don't need him. You know, so anyway, I tried to signal. I'm gonna subtly signal to Dax. You know, obviously he's not paying attention to his screen. But I'm pretty sure he's coming on at the top of the hour here. We will wait and see. I got some news I want to talk about when we come back from break. Let me finish the thought about HBO. I think that if they bring in, and I'm going to be curious to see who's going to come in and buy the fights. But here's the thing. What's wrong? Back in the old days, they used to have, when they had fights on TV, you know, when it was popular, and it's coming back, you know, hey, listen, all the naysays about the sport, I've been telling you for the last couple of years, we're in a huge resurgence, and if you don't see it now, you're never going to see it. But back in the day, they used to have matchmakers. They used to hire matchmakers to actually help get the fights, buy the fights for the networks. What's wrong with finding a matchmaker, an accomplished matchmaker, an experienced matchmaker, a matchmaker that knows the game? And I'm going to refer to the late, great Johnny Boz. He was a matchmaker that knew every fighter. You know, now I'm not saying, you know, that there's another guy like him, but a lot of good matchmakers know the fighters. You got some matchmakers out there that, you know, you call them, you know, the butchers. You know, they're the ones that lead the lambs to slaughter. There's some matchmakers out there that are proficient in finding that breathing, you know, dead man, you know, that punching bag with arms and legs. You know, they've made a career out of finding the opponent, the so-called opponent. But then there's the group of matchmakers that actually know the fighters. They know who's good. They know that a guy's record that's 12-6 is a pretty tough guy, you know, and they know that this 12-6 guy would beat the snot out of this 22-0 guy. You know, matchmakers like that, guys that know the sport, guys that not only know the sport of boxing, that can watch film and tell you what a fighter's doing, but a guy that knows the pool of fighters that are available to him. That's who I want. If I'm running the network, if I'm Kenny Hirschman, I want a guy to replace this Kerry Davis, a matchmaker. I want a boxing guy. I want to say, new buyer, this is your job. Your job is to find me competitive fights. Forget the old rules of looking for 24-0 guys. Forget that. Forget the rules of finding some sanctioning body to make this a world title. Forget that. What I want is I want a product that when people associate my brand with that product and they see a HBO fight night, that they know that even if they never heard of the guy, that it's going to be an exciting fight. A talented couple of fighters that are going to be fighting on my network. If I'm Kenny Hirschman, that's what I want. I want a guy that can pick out the fights that are going to be entertaining for the fans. That is what we need. We don't need a guy that looks at a piece of paper that doesn't know a right hook from a fish hook or a left hook from a fish hook or an uppercut from an overhand right. You know, there's guys, believe it or not, and as funny as it sounds, there's a lot of those guys in the sport of boxing today making the decisions on which fights you and me are watching on the weekend. And, you know, half the time these guys don't know anything about the sport. It's a job. They hate going to their job. Why not get a guy that knows the business, that knows the fighters, put him in this position that buys these fights, and I guarantee you will be treated to some good stuff. And not that HBO didn't have good stuff in the past, but I with this war that's going on, I agree with Biggerback, and I've said it myself, that we're going to benefit. Trust me, the boxing fan will benefit from the war.
Talkin' Boxing with Billy C now has official merchandise available on TalkinBoxing.com. T-shirts, sweatshirts, hoodies and mugs, and yes, even undergarments. Talkin' Boxing apparel is the perfect gift for the boxing fan in your life. Log on to www.talkinboxing.com. That's TalkinBoxing.com. And place your order today.
Your favorite LTV. Yeah. My name is Tonton Bichard. You and me, we're watching now Talking Boxing with Billy T on your favorite TV. LDLTV. Yeah.
Talking Boxing Studios, sipping a fine wine before you're even out of bed. You should be thinking, damn, I wish I had a mustache like his. It's the Talkin' Boxing with Billy C show. He's Billy C, and you're not. Sucks to be you.
Now let's dig into
it. I am Alden Pawnee's former NBA player, and you're watching Talkin' Boxing on LDLTV with my man, Billy C.
Billy C, as the new champ, can we ask you a few questions?
Why, certainly.
Okay, your fans would like to know how you and your corner have successfully walloped the competition.
We're not ordinary people. We're morons.
Anything else?
I'm a victim of circumstance.
Did your success finally come when you made the show 5 days a week for 2 hours? What do you think?
I'm trying to think, but nothing happens.
Now, please tell the listeners what you've learned from making it this far.
Certainly. If it wastes you don't succeed, keep on sucking till you do succeed.
Great words of wisdom, Billy C. Keep up the great work as the undisputed People's Champion with your show, Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. Any last words to anyone who's listening?
This is your fault, you bonehead.
And we're back. You're listening to the Talking Boxing with Billy C show. You're watching us on the Fight Now television channel. Glad you could join us. I'm getting roasted here. You know, I think John from LDLTV, he wanted to do a Billy C type roast show, and I thought it was going to be like dinner, you know. But apparently, his idea of roasting was a little different than mine. But anyway, my man Henry Haskup. Now you hear the name a lot because he provides us with our trivia questions. He's a guru when it comes to that stuff. But he just confirmed with me about El Murray. Not only was he ranked number one, but I guess for 43 months he was ranked at number one from December 1944 to April 1949. So talk about a guy that is forgotten. And I promise Tony Treem and I are going to we're getting some information that nobody else has on him, and we'll share you with that. He's one of these great guys of the sport. I wish I could say this is a great guy. Nah, he's a great guy. Daxx Kahn joins us right now. What's up, great guy?
Hey, what's up? I've been trying to call you since 2:45, and then we're on the air going, oh, trying to get Daxx Kahn's attention. Now you decide you're going to answer?
Well, look at the tab. Didn't you see the tab, man? Come on, Mr. Tab boy.
Come on, man. I don't get paid enough that tab.
No, not the screen. No, not the. I didn't say I was picking up any tab. Whoa, slow it down, Dax. I said look at the tab at the top. But anyway, I was trying to ask. The last time we talked, you know, I might as well just throw it out there live. are you doing a roundup today, or are we moving on?
I am doing a roundup. Oh. This is a busy weekend, man.
I know. Well, get it out the way, man. Go ahead. Knock yourself out.
Here we go. Starting Friday, ESPN2 Friday Night Fights is going to be hosted by Goose and Tudor Promotions. It's going to feature a lightweight main event when unbeaten Andre Killamoff takes on John Molina. In the co-feature, super middleweight Farah Ennis is going to take on Anthony Hanshaw at the Turning Stone Resort and Casino in New York, not far from where this weekend's International Boxing Hall of Fame event is taking place and where you're going to be Friday, Bill, on Showtime. Miguel Cotto is going to be promoting a card, and the main event is going to be a WBC International Silver Light Middleweight title bout as belt holder Jorge Melendez defends against Nick Brinson. As co-feature, a battle of unbeatens happens between super bantamweight Jonathan Vidal and Mario Munoz. Munoz is a power puncher who has 10 of his 13 wins come by stoppage. Also on that card is going to be a slew of unblemished fighters, including lightweight Samuel Cotinique and super featherweight Jeffrey Fontanez. On June 8th, which is really the busy night of the week this week for boxing, starting out in Canada at the Bell Center in Montreal, Quebec, light heavyweight champion Chad Dawson puts his WBC light heavyweight title up against the powerful Adonis Superman Stevenson in the main event. And the co-feature, as you mentioned before, two very exciting unbeaten fighters, Yuriarkis Gamboa and Darlis Perez, battle for the interim WBA World Lightweight title. And in separate bouts, super featherweight prospect Jose Pedraza, light middleweight Sebastian Bouchard, and fan favorite middleweight David Lemieux are also slated to be in action. That card will be broadcast on HBO and is co-promoted by Gary Shaw and GYM Promotions. In Berlin, Germany, on Germany ARD and Hungary Digisport TV, WBO cruiserweight champion Marco Kattenhauk will defend his belt when he meets Ola Afalabi for the third time. In an IBF Intercontinental Light Heavyweight title showdown, belt holder and KO artist Robert Wojciech looks to keep his strap and add win number 12 along with KO number 11 to his resume as he faces another unbeaten fighter, Darius Sake, in light heavyweight Edward Gutnetchik takes on Rich Vidal for the vacant WBA Intercontinental Light Heavyweight title. That card is hosted by Sourland Events. What I really like about that card, Bill, is that we have not only one, not two, but we have three major sanctioning bodies allowing one version or another of a title to be on that card. It's not too often that we can actually see a promoter get those guys willing all to put one belt or another up on there. You know, we'll see one, we'll see two, but hardly ever three. In Tijuana, Baja California, Mexico, Del Pueblo, De Leon, and Baja Boxing Promotions team up for a quality event. In the main event, light welterweight Humberto Soto defends his WBC International Silver light welterweight title against Hiroshi Nakamura. In the co-feature, light flyweight Luis Aja puts his WBC International Silver light flyweight title down against Jose Alfredo Zuniga. And super bantamweight Ray Vargas defends his WBC youth super bantamweight title against Cecilio Santos. I don't know if anybody out there has seen Vargas in action, but man, can this bang. 13 of his 14 wins can come by stoppage. It's going to be a great card. Also in Baja California, Mexico, Xenifer Promotions will broadcast in Mexico Azteca. In the main event, welterweight Jorge Paez Jr. takes on Edison Garcia, and in the co-feature, Jose Zabata takes on former world title challenger Urban Antillian. In Morocco, Toile Verte Productions, oh man, that's a hard one to say, will host a WBF world title doubleheader. First, Nadia Hakimi takes on Guadalupe Martinez for the vacant world WBF female bantamweight title. And in the main event, cruiserweight Rashid El Hadik battles Lars Buchholz for the interim WBF cruiserweight title. I think this is the first that I can remember for Morocco ever being on the rundown here on our show. In the United Kingdom, on a card hosted by Hennessy Sports to be broadcast on United Kingdom Channel 5, USA Wealth TV, super middleweight James DeGalli defends his WBC silver super middleweight title against Stefan Bozic. In undercard action and separate bouts, we will see heavyweight Hughie Fury, super bantamweight Kid Galahad, and middleweight Chris Eubank Jr. all in action, all who are undefeated. This is going to be the fifth time Huey has fought since March, and he has three more proposed bouts before the end of July. You talk about a busy pace for this 18-year-old kid. Tyson one time, and Tyson said, you know, he reminds him of a throwback, and this pace he really does, because I think he's got the busiest schedule in boxing right now. At the Horseshoe Casino in Hammond, Indiana, Bobby Hintz features a main event between two journeymen that should make a good matchup. Heavyweights Fezo Kendo and Derek Rossi meet in the main event for Kendo's WBA Federal Latin Heavyweight title and the vacant NABA Heavyweight Championship. In the undercard, super middleweight prospect Mike Jimenez will also be in action. At the Hard Rock Hotel Casino in Las Vegas, Nevada, where Tony Trim will be, super flyweight Juan Carlos Sanchez Jr. defends his belt against undefeated Roberto Domingo Sosa. On the undercard in separate bouts, there will be three undefeated highly daughter prospects in action as well. Super featherweight Jose Felix Jr., super bantamweight Jesse Magdaleno, and heavyweight Andy Ruiz Jr. That card is being hosted by Top Rank and will broadcast on Unimas TV. And the big one this weekend on Showtime at the Home Depot Center in Carson, California, two of the sport's most exciting fighters will face off for the WBA Intercontinental Welterweight title in the main event of a talent-rich card. Belt holder and former 140-pound titleist Marcos Maidana and Jose Cito Lopez will slug it out, hoping to take a step closer towards a world title shot. The co-main event features light middleweights Erison De Lara and Alfredo Angulo for the interim WBA World Light Middleweight title. One of the sport's hottest prospects, unbeaten light middleweight Jermell Charlo, faces Demetrius Hopkins in defense of Charlo's USBA light middleweight title. Welterweights Yoshihiro Kamagai and Johan Perez step in for the division's vacant WBA International title. And the separate bouts on the undercard, we will see some future stars in action as super featherweight Ronnie Rios, lightweight Jamie Kavanaugh, and super bantamweight Manuel Avila, who are all defeated at the moment, are going to step in the ring, showcase their wares. An exciting, 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 I can't say it enough times, night on this June 8th. Bill, I don't even know which card to watch. Unfortunately, I'm going to be up in Canastota, so I'm hoping my DVR can record more than one.
On which show? Which one? All of the stuff that's on TV, you mean, right?
All that's on TV throughout the world. Every card I mentioned is on TV throughout the world.
Yeah, no, there's a lot of stuff this week for sure.
And if you're like me, I'm one of the guys that, you know, I got that big package with my cable system. You know what? I can watch boxing 24/7. And what I do is I DVR every possible thing I can. And, you know, throughout those days, I watch it, man. I don't miss a thing.
Yeah, well, you know, one of the greatest inventions really was the DVR, man. That's That's what I love because, well, now, geez, I'm getting crazy. The other night I stayed up till 9:30, man. You know that's crazy for me. You know,
yeah, that is crazy.
I know. 9:30. Wow. I know. So I might even make it. I might even make it. You know, I'm the only guy, and I thought I was the only guy on the planet that, you know, would DVR these fights that come on 11 and 12, and I'd be watching them. I'd be watching them at 3 and 4 in the morning, you know, and it was still the same day. I was just, you know, I was like delayed. I was West Coast, you know.
I get my DVR running in every room because the DVR that I have to my company only allows you to record 2 channels at a time. So I record 2 in the living room. I record 2 in one bedroom. I record another in the other bedroom while I watch a fight card. And then once they're all recorded, that's what I spend my Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday doing and talking about.
No, I hear you. I try to do the same thing. I find channels I don't even know that I have. But anyway, great job as usual. A lot of stuff. You know, went from feast to famine. Last time we had nothing. You know, there was nothing going on. But
yeah, last time I'm sitting there, you know, I'm trying to instigate fights. You know, this week I don't have too many to talk about.
I might have to call some of my Goomba buddies up here to have a little chat with the deer. You know, the deer eat all my shrubs. They're crapping all over my lawn. They're starting to become a nuisance. They really are.
Yeah, speaking of crap, I told you, we were talking off the phone. I don't know if you have them cicadas up by you. You know, they're all over the place down by me. They come out once every 17
years. Wait a minute. That's right. What's the deal with them? People are telling me, what do they actually look like?
They kind of look like a cross between a beetle and a grasshopper, you know, except they have these wings and they got these big buggy green eyes. They're real ugly, and what they do is they leave their shells behind.
Wait a minute.
And the shells are all over the place.
Wait a minute. Daxx,
I'm going by, and they got this big bullfrog on my walkway that's sitting there, and the kids pointed out to me, you know, so I'm like, oh, check that out. Now they're going, oh, pick it up. So, you know, I pick up the bullfrog like an idiot, and the thing pees all over me, and I stood there like a little girl just about crying. I couldn't believe what happened. My wife and kids are making fun of me. You know, and these cicadas, when they get going, man, let me tell you something. They let out the most loudest, annoying, shrill of a noise when you get 10, 15,000 of them all at one time.
Yeah, I don't know if we have them up here. I haven't heard them, but you described
it.
You described them. It sounds like a couple of chicks I've woken up next to a couple of times. So
I went to bed with an ugly one. I woke up with a few.
Yeah, I know. That's a good, it's a good sign. I tell you, that's the old rule. You know, it's a good sign if you wake up next to a decent looking chick, you did okay. You know, so
you know she's really ugly when you go home without the arm because you chewed it off rather than risk waking her.
Yeah, when you're trying to get free, when you see your arm still in the handcuff on the bed rail and it's all chewed off, you know you were trying to get the hell out of there. But hey, what's your thoughts on a couple of the fights? Chad Dawson against Adonis Stevenson. You know, a lot of people are picking Adonis. I'm not a big fan of Chad Dawson. I really am not. But Adonis Stevenson, to me, as much as I like to see him win, I don't know if he's versatile enough. What do you think?
I don't know. Chad, you know, if Chad goes in there napping, which seems like he has his last few fights, he always, you know, he's like he's going through the motions. And somebody like Adonis, who, like you said, isn't really versatile, you know, and he's pretty easy to figure out, especially somebody like Chad, who really is a top-notch boxer when he wants to be. But, you know, with his lack of motivation, and I don't know, you know, maybe once he feels, you know, a little bit of Stevenson's power, maybe he's going to start getting some flashbacks going on about, you know, the way Andre Ward just beat him up inside the ring. You know, I'm going to go with Chad, you know, just considering, you know, the skill level, and so, but I'm not going to be that surprised if Adonis Stevenson goes in there and blows him out.
How about Josito Lopez against Marcos Maidana?
That might be the fight of the weekend because, you know, Josito Lopez is an action guy. He'll stand toe-to-toe, and he's fighting a guy that's closer to his size. You know, Marcos Maidana, even though he's, you know, at welterweight, and Josito Lopez is, you know, more known as a natural light welterweight, you know, there's really not much of a size difference between them at all. I think, you know, Josito Lopez can outbox him, but if he makes the mistake of standing there trying to trade with him, Lopez is going to go to sleep. But I'm going to pick Lopez by decision if he fights smart.
Erslandy Lara against Alfredo Angulo. I love this fight. It's a classic, you know, style makes fights type of a thing. You know, we've seen some kinks in Angulo's armor. Maybe not because he's definitely a one-dimensional fighter. Is this Orlandi Lara's chance to really, you know, get himself in the mix? He's been on the cusp. He's been robbed a couple of times. But this is a big fight for him. How do you see this one shaking out?
I think Lara, you know, he can outwork and he can win, you know, definitely, because, you know, in the last few fights, you know, since his return, he hasn't looked very well at all. You know, Alfredo, you know, ever since he came back from this deportation thing, you know, even his body just looks worn out. You know, who knows how he's been since his last fight, but he looks like a guy who aged a lot overnight. And, you know, he may not, is he even in the country? I don't know, because with that terrorist book that he has, I'm not even sure if they're letting him over the border. But, you know, I'm going to go with Lara on this, because unless Angulo has went to training camp and he's really stepped it up since the last time we've seen him, I don't see anything in him anymore. I think he's a done fighter.
Marco Captain Huck and Ola Aflobi, it's a good fight. I'm a big fan of Huck, but, you know, a listener not too long ago had emailed me and said that he was kind of a mouthy kind of a guy and you know, talked smack a lot and everything else, and I never really noticed it, but I have noticed it lately, and he does talk a lot of smack. But he's a good fighter. But Afolobi seems to fight well against Huck. Do you see this one going which way?
I'm gonna go Afolobi, because I just think Huck has become a little bit overconfident. He's fighting at home. I think he's gonna depend a little bit on that hometown advantage. And yeah, he's gotten arrogant. He's always had, you know, a little bit of a swagger to him, but he's definitely gotten arrogant. And you know what? You know, a lot of people forget, and I only think about this because we were talking about him in the chat room before. You know, a lot of people forget that, you know, Huck was knocked out by Steve Cunningham in his only loss. And, you know, so it's not as if, you know, the guy isn't susceptible. And, you know, if he comes into this fight against a guy who knows him well, who knows, you know, whatever tricks he has and is used to facing him, and, you know, and at home relying on that, I'm going to go Afolabi on this. I think he's going to be the new champion.
Wow. You know, remember, that's who Huck beat to get the belt. And in Afolobi's last fight, it was a draw. It was pretty much of a controversial outcome as well. A couple of other fights, and then we'll let you go. These are tough, man, because, you know, to tell you the truth, the two young fighters, Henry Maldonado, who's had a, you know, pretty decent run against, you know, better than subpar opposition, going up against Jesse Magladeno. Who do you like in that one?
Jesse. At home, you know, the Magladeno brothers at home, you know, they're sensational, aren't they? They feed off the crowd. And, you know, so I'm going to go with Jesse in that one. I think Jesse is going to not only win, but I think he's going to win sensationally, because him and his brother, their name, you know, you never hear the Magdaleno, it's the Magdaleno brothers. And then after, you know, what happened to his brother over in China, you know, it's almost like how you see, you know, the Billy C, you got the Billy C brand, and right now it's almost, you know, the Magdaleno brand. And a loss for him, I think, would hurt both of them in terms of marketing. So I look for him to win this, and he's going to win it sensationally.
Dan the Man Henderson must be... What time is it over there? He's already got like five or six big pints, as they would call it in him. I'm sure he does. You know, they're talking about some stuff, and he says when he's my age, he's gonna have the Hugh Hefner thing going on. Come on, man. You know what I mean? That's he wants to be Hugh Hefner thing. You know, I give you.
We're gonna have the Hugh Hefner thing.
Dan the Man, our own Dan the Man.
I'm in front of the computer, so I can't see the chat.
Yeah, Dan the Man, you know, and, you know, come on, Hugh Hef, I mean, come on. You know, it's a totally different situation, but Dan the Man is crazy. He's crazy, man. Gamboa, Darley Perez, we had an email earlier that said he's predicted an upset, that he thinks that Darley Perez might be a little too much for my man Gamboa. What does Daxx Kahn think?
I would like to pick Gamboa, but the only thing is that Uriarchus has been shown, you know, to be susceptible to those punches, you know, and now he's, you know, up at lightweight. So if Perez figures out a way to tag him often, I'm going to pick Perez. But I would say Perez can pull the upset off, but I'm going to go with Gamboa in a tough fight.
And another,
it's not going to be easy. That's a great carding candidate, to be honest with you.
And one last one, Juan Carlos Sanchez against Roberto Socia. That's a tough one.
Yeah, that's one of those things I got to close my eyes and just throw a dart. So I'm going to go Juan Carlos. That's a pick 'em. That really is. I can't pick on that one. You got me on the fence there.
You know, the funny thing about that fight is you look at Juan Carlos Sanchez, and he's the champ, right? And he's got a couple of losses, and he's a young kid. And when you look at the level of opposition that he's fought, and then you look at Roberto Socia, he hasn't fought the same opposition, but he's undefeated and he's fought way more fights, you know. So it's another tough one, man. It's a hard week for the challenge.
You can't always go by the record, you know. That's some of the things that I know. I've heard you talk to people. I've talked to people, you know. Especially here, a lot of the old timers talk to people and tell me, you know, you can't go with the record. Probably one of the most recent examples of that with that being was, you know, Salgado, when he beat Wanma both times. Look how many losses he has. You know, look how many losses Glenn Johnson had before he became world champion. And one of my favorites, one of my hometown buddies from Schenectady, Ronald Phillips, you know, all the losses Ronald Phillips has had in his career. But, you know, how many world titles did he win as well? So it's not the resume of the wins, losses, Bill. You know that. I know that. You know, it's the quality of who you're beating. One of the examples I use all the time in that is Thomas Damgaard versus Arturo Gatti, who, you know, getting inducted this weekend to the International Boxing Hall of Fame. Arturo went over there. I think Damgaard was 33-0, 35-0, and Gatti just blew him out. But look who he was, you know, 33-35-0 against.
No, you're right. You're right. Well, listen, man, great job in the roundup. Thanks for your predictions, and I'll be seeing you at the Sausage and Pepper tent tomorrow.
Yeah, and don't forget, man, we're going to be recording our roundtable show Saturday morning.
Don't worry, I didn't forget. But
all right, I'll see you soon. Have a great week, everybody.
Take care. That's Daxx Kahn, and he's going to meet me at the Sausage and Pepper tent. You know, that's where all the fat bastards hang out, and that's where I'm going to be for sure. Did you catch what's going on with Jorge Silva? Now, Jorge Silva, he's one of those fighters that came onto the scene, and you know, we didn't know much about him, and he fought Alfredo Angulo in one of his most recent fights, and it was a great fight, and he rocked Angulo, and you know, he went the distance, and he kind of lost a controversial decision. And after the fight, Team Angulo was questioning his. They were questioning if he was on the juice, man. They thought that he was on the juice for sure. And Silva, and I've been talking about this, Jorge Silva said, "Come on, man. Just because he punches like a girl, you know, he should shut the f up and all this stuff." And you know, it kind of fizzled out a little bit. Well, it's back going on, and apparently he said, and I quote, because Angulo. Angulo's team is making excuses for his performance and why he, you know, didn't knock this kid out and why he was rocked and stuff like that. And they're still suggesting that Jorge Silva was on, you know, a performance enhancing drug. And Silva said, and I quote, "Don't look towards the past before you because you can't change it." He says, you know, this is a message I have with your up-and-coming fight. He says, "Alfredo Angulo better, and his trainer, Virgil Hunter, better stop luring to the fact that I took banned substances prior to the fight." He says, "The rumors have bothered." He's been saying that the rumors have bothered him and everything else. And he says, and I quote, I think he should stop his crying and concentrate on his career just like I've done with mine. If it hurt him so much that I exposed him, here I am for whenever he wants to do it again," Silva said. He said that he's willing to face him again, but if the second times happen, it will be under different circumstances, since he would expect more than a week of warning and without having to drop nearly 20 pounds like he did the first time. And that's another thing. He was a last-minute sub and was spent when he went out there. So, you know, that we got a phone ringing here, and I guess that's a good time for me to take a break. We'll be right back. Well, you know what? That phone just stopped, and I have a minute or two before I have to take a break, so I want to continue with these quotes. The bottom line is, he says, I wasn't in shape. And he said, even then, he said, that puppy, which I love that line, because, you know, they call him, Alfredo Angulo. You know, he calls him a puppy, you know, instead of the dog, you know. But he's a puppy. He says, that puppy couldn't hurt me. He responded when he was told this is what he was saying after Angulo is still saying that he was talking smack about him. But, I love that. I love this kid, man. And I would like to see a rematch. Could you imagine what it would be like, you know? Silva's going to be fighting next week, I think. He's fighting June 15th in Mexico. He is going to be challenging for the NABF welterweight title, and we'll see what happens with him. Remember, he's got 20 wins, 16 coming by knockout. He's got three losses and a couple of draws. And if I'm not mistaken, he was a guy that I think he went to law school, or his parents are very well off, and you know, I think I remember hearing something about that. And you know, he's one of the rare cases that chose boxing, out of desire to fight rather than out of necessity to try and better his situation. So I think I'm his new biggest fan. I really am. Jorge Pantera Silva, the guy that calls Alfredo Angulo, he says that he punches like a girl, and he's called the puppy, you know. So I love that. He should try some of Alex T's housebreaking wee-wee pads for and send them to Alfredo Angulo. One more thing before I take a break for real. Is a European title on the line on Saturday in Italy. You know, you got to love Italy, at least I do, when the promoters at OP2000 is going to have they're going to have a couple of European titles on the line. For the vacant European super lightweight belt, Michele Di Rocco, who's 34-1 with a draw with 15 knockouts, is taking on Englishman Lenny Dawes. Remember him? 25 wins, 2 losses, and 2 draws. And for the vacant European super middleweight title, Italian, at least he's living in Italy now, Mohamed Ali Nadai, who's 23-1 with 13 knockouts, is taking on Frenchman Christopher Ribrassi, who's 20 wins, 2 losses, 2 draws, with 5 of his wins coming by knockout. Those are the European belts. They have an undercard that's going to feature a WBC silver middleweight champ, Domenico Spada, who's 36-4 with 18 KOs, taking on Norbert Sicaris for his WBC silver belt, and a couple of other good fights with some young fighters. So I'll be looking forward to getting the results on that. I don't have any access to that, but anyway. One other thing, I lied. I got one more thing I got to say. No, that comes at the end of the show. Saul Canelo Alvarez is, going to get the word from the WBC. Now, the WBC is warning him that he's got to choose between the WBA and the WBC. And even though he's letting you know who, even though the WBC is letting you know who keep two belts, they got this up for grabs because the WBC says, we do not support unifications, which makes me sick. The question is are they really going to come down on Saul Alvarez? He is all-time, 100% Mexican, and we all know that Jose Suleiman favors the Mexican fighters. He is good for anybody that anybody's belt that he wears. Apparently, Jose Suleiman will be meeting with Golden Boy in a couple of days, I think early next week, to determine the fate of which belt will actually be on the line when that fight happens. And the WBA had a comment that I'll tell you in about 2.
And we're back.
LDLTV, streaming live to you the best in amateur USA and Golden Gloves events, professional boxing, live mixed martial arts, major concerts, music, comedy, special red carpet events, professional pool, beach volleyball, car racing, boat racing, live corporate events, and much, much more. All live to you in crystal clear, smooth streaming video. LDLTV. Live, down the line, the best every time.
And we're back.
LDLTV.
See, you don't call anymore. You don't stalk me. I mean, I appreciate the occasional shout out, but I lie in my bed shouting your name out all the time. Nothing. I don't know what happened. We were so close. And everybody likes to watch Billy C talking about boxing on LDLTV, but you don't give me the love you used to. I need more shout outs, Billy C, man. Give me some freaking love. Get myself all worked up just thinking about you and that mustache. It's delicious. You're watching Talking Boxing with Billy C and his mighty mustache on LDLTV. It's delicious.
Get the justice they deserve for almost 30 years, and we could do the same for you.
Now back to Talking Boxing with Billy C. He may not have an Excellence in Broadcasting Award, but the night's still young.
And he's got martinis.
So you never know what may be by morning. It's Talking Boxing with Billy C.
Talking Boxing with Billy C.
The one, the only, Don King.
Makes me feel good, Billy, to have you, the number one show in the country, Talking Boxing with Billy. So I invite each and every American that's listening to this great show to tune in, because we want you to be there with Billy and me.
And we're back. You're listening to the Talking Boxing with Billy C show. You're watching us. You're watching us on the Fight Now television channel. Glad you could join us. And, you know, I tell you, this whole WBC thing, it just kills me. You know, he's going to make Canelo, a guy that they pretty much set up, and I'm talking to he, Jose Suleiman. Is going to make them choose, and the WBA is sitting there. You know, they're like the younger brother. You know, and he's sitting there. We have no problem. We have no problem with unifications, Canelo. If you want to, proudly wear our belt. He says, by the way, we'll even let you and Floyd fight for the super championship for the WBA. And should that happen, then guess what? The fight that's going on. Which is in the books as an interim belt between Ruslan de Lara and Alfredo Angulo this weekend. Should Canelo somehow walk away from the WBA belt and get the opportunity to fight for the super belt in the junior middleweight division, then the Ruslan de Lara fight. The winner of the Ruslan de Lara and Alfredo Angulo fight would become the champion. So, man, it's like follow the bouncing title. And one last thing I want to say. And you know what? If I'm Canelo, he flexed all his muscles and showing that, he wasn't going to be second fiddle to Floyd. At least he tried. I think he needs to continue the flexing. And continue to show people like the WBC that he's more valuable than that green belt. And I'm pulling. I'm curious to see what Canelo's got to say. One last thing, and then I'm going to break down these fights because we got 12 of them. It's going to take me a while. Miguel Kessler or Andre Ward. Who do you like better for Carl Froch? You know, Carl Froch is a promoter, Eddie Hearn from Matchmaker Sports, is evaluating who's going to be the next opponent. We all know that Andre Ward and Carl Froch would be a good fight, regardless of where it is. I think that Andre Ward should fight over in England. I think it's only fair. I'd like to see how Andre fares outside of his home base of California. But to be honest with you, I think for money, and maybe I'm wrong, maybe the people of England would rather see Ward come over there and fight Froch, but I have this strange feeling that a neutral location, they fought the first fight in Denmark, the second fight in England, and then find another neutral location in Europe to have Kessler Frotch 3. I think all parties involved could actually make out a little better. But that's my thoughts and opinion there. And speaking of thoughts and opinions, you know, I very rarely express my opinion, but I'm going to go through the fights. And I don't have them in any particular order. We got 12 on the challenge. I see 12 of them right here. What you got to do if you're interested in becoming part of the challenge, all you have to do is email me, Billy@TalkinBoxing. That's TalkinBoxing.com. And tell me you want to get involved, and you will. You'll be set for next week. There's a couple of rules we'll go over, and that's it. We got a great group of people. And if you want to see the standings currently right now, go visit the website at www.billycboxing.com. All right, first fight I'm going to be picking is probably one of the toughest ones. Ola Afolobi against Marco Kattenhoek. And Ola Afolobi, he's a former World Cruiserweight Champion. He lost the title to Captain Hook in 2009. He's 33 years old. He's hasn't fought in over years, so the computer doesn't rank him after they haven't fought in a year. His record is 19 wins, 9 coming by knockout, a couple of losses, never been stopped, 4 draws. He's got 4 draws. He's 6'3". You know, it's kind of funny. He's 6'3". He's got an inch and a half over Marco Captain Hook, but every shot, every publicity shot I've seen, and even when the two guys were in the ring, it does not look like that to me. I don't know, man. I don't know. But he's 6'3" on paper, 75-inch reach, 146 rounds of pro with a 36% knockout ratio. He moved up the ladder, fought some good fights, won the world title against Enzo Macronelli in 2009. In his very first world title defense, he lost it via 12-round decision to Marco Captain Hook. He won the interim belt when he beat Valerie Boudreau in 2012, which set up the rematch with Marco Captain Hook. Very controversial majority draw in that one. And that happened to have been his last fight, which was in May of last year. Now, Marco Captain Hook, well, we all know about this guy. He's been a world champion pretty much and fought for world titles all the way back since 2009. He did lose his a bid at a world heavyweight championship when he fought Alexander Povetkin, which, in my opinion, he won the fight. He won the fight. He got robbed. His record is 35 wins, 25 coming by knockout. He did have 2 losses, and he was stopped one time, and that was against Steve USS Cunningham. He's ranked number 3 in the world by the computer at cruiserweight. He's only 28 years old, 73-inch reach, 6'1½" in height, and he's got 263 rounds as a pro with a 66% knockout ratio. Now, how do I think it's going to go? Well, I'll tell you. What I think. What's going to happen in this fight, and if Marco Captain Hook, this is my knock on him. He got into a habit in his last couple of fights fighting in spurts. He did it against Ola Afolobi, and he did it against Alexander Povetkin. He can't do that against Afolobi in this fight. He's got to, hopefully he's conditioned well, and he's got to fight 100% the whole round, the whole fight. You know, 12 rounds. You know, being active, you know, whatever it is. I'm not saying he's got to wail and throw punches for 3 minutes of 12 rounds. I'm saying don't pick your times and fight, you know, 4 rounds here, then take a couple of rounds off and then complain about close fights. He's got to fight fully. If he does, he'll win. If he doesn't, he's going to lose. Who am I picking? Captain Hook. I'm picking Marco Captain Hook. In a really good, interesting fight between two young fighters, Jesse Magladeno goes up against Henry Maldonado. Jesse Magladeno, a great kid. I had the pleasure of meeting him thanks to Tony Treem. Very dedicated kid. You'd see him on the street. You'd never know he's a boxer. He looks like he should be working in a library or something. And then you make fun of him, and he kicks the snot out of you. 14-0 with 10 knockouts, number 58 in the world at super bantamweight, as the computer says. He's only 21 years old. He's just a baby. 66-inch reach, 5'4", 41 rounds as a pro with a 71% knockout ratio. His best win as a pro, in my opinion, was not his last fight, but the fight before. He fought Jonathan Aureliano, who he won via an 8-round decision. 13-1-1 was Aureliano when he fought. His first win, really, against top opposition, in my opinion, was Aldemar Silva Santos, which was four fights ago. But he's been moved along pretty well, and he's been progressively, his level of competition has been moved up progressively nice. Henry Maldonado is who he fights. His record is 16 wins, 2 losses. He was stopped both times. He's got 11 knockouts. He's a smaller guy. He's ranked at bantamweight, number 68 by the computer. He's not much older, but he is 4 years older than Jesse. He's 25 years old. 77 rounds as a pro with a 58% knockout ratio. His last fight was against top-level opposition in Julio Ceja, which he got knocked out in the fifth round. His two best wins came in 2012. The first one, the first one was in 2011 against Darwin Zamora, who was 18-5. That was a good win, 10th round knockout. And he also beat Jose Dominguez back in 2012 in April. Those were his two best wins. Who's going to win this one? Jesse. I'm picking Jesse Maldonado. The next fight, Jonathan Vidal against Mario Munoz. Another tough one if you like close fights. Mario Munoz, Yayo is his nickname. 13 wins, no losses. He's got a draw. 10 of his wins coming by knockout. He's ranked in the super bantamweight division by the computer at number 85. He's 22 years old, 5'7", 52 rounds a pro with a 67% knockout ratio. He's fought some good opposition, some experienced opposition. He fought Moses Flores for a youth title that the fight ended as a no contest. That took place November of last year. He steps in with undefeated Jonathan Vidal. He's 17-0 with 9 knockouts. He's ranked number 91 in the bantamweight division. Now, this is an interesting thing because Jonathan Vidal is actually moving up in weight to fight him. 62 rounds as a pro with a 53% knockout ratio. His last four fights were all against a good opposition going back to 2011. Cecilio Santos, he won in an 8-round decision. He also beat Felix Perez, who was 7-3. Angel Cruz, who was 6-1 with a draw. And Josean Figueroa, who was 8-2. I'm picking Jonathan Vidal. I think he's going to take the extra weight, no problem, and win this fight. The next fight is a real tough one to pick. Juan Carlos Sanchez against Roberto Sosa. And I got this messed up here. Oh, I'm sorry. I missed one. Jose Pedraza against Sergio Villanueva is the fight I've got in front of me right now. Jose Pedraza, he's 12-0 with 8 knockouts, ranked number 95th in the super featherweight division. He's only 24 years old, 55 rounds of pro with a 67% knockout ratio. Listen, he's got the normal level of opposition for 12 fights is what we see today. He's stepping in with Sergio Villanueva, who's fought clearly the tougher opposition. His record, 25 wins, 13 coming by knockout, 2 losses, 1 stoppage, and a couple of draws. He's only 21, 149 rounds as a pro. He fought Jose Manuel Osorio back in 2009, which was a huge step up in quality of his opposition. Here's the thing. I think Sergio Villanueva has fought tougher guys, but he's either lost or drew to them. The 25 wins were against very, very weak opposition. I'm taking Jose Pedraza in this one, even though he's stepping up. Now, the fight that I just mistakenly said before this one, it is a tough one. It's for the IBF Super Flyweight belt, and the champion is Juan Carlos Sanchez Jr., who is the Super Flyweight champ for the IBF. 15 wins, 8 coming by knockout. He's only got 1 loss. He was stopped. He's ranked number 1 in the Super Flyweight division. He's got 1 draw. He's 5'8.5", which is kind of tall for a super flyweight. 87 rounds as a pro with a 47% knockout ratio. You look at this guy's record since he's won the title and several fights before. He's been fighting very good opposition, slick fighters, experienced fighters. This kid is the real deal at 22 years old. He steps in with Roberto Domingo Sosa, who's 28 years old, ranked number 27 in the super flyweight division, undefeated at 24-0 with 14 knockouts, 107 rounds of pro to 58% knockout ratio. His last fight was against good fighter Zolani Teat. Well, that was a good one. He's also had several good fights in a row. This is a really tough fight to pick. To me, it's a 50-50 fight, but I'm leaning towards Juan Carlos Sanchez. It seems that Sanchez is one of these fighters that ever since he won the title, he's kind of stepped it up a notch. I'm picking Sanchez Jr. in this one. Alfredo Angulo going up against Ursandi Lara. Former world junior middleweight champion is Alfredo Angulo. 22 wins, 2 losses. He was only stopped once. 18 of his wins come up by knockout. Junior middleweight, he's 30 years old, ranked number 19 in the world by the computer. 5'10", 69-inch reach, 99 rounds as a pro. His last fight, he was hitting like a puppy against Jorge Silva in a very, I thought it was a controversial loss. He did win a unanimous decision. I don't know how. His only knockout loss came in the hands of James Kirkland in a war. 99 rounds of pro, 75% knockout ratio, like I said. He fights Ursandi Lara, who's also 30 years old, junior middleweight, 5'9", 72.5-inch reach, 98 rounds of pro with a 55% knockout ratio. He's the interim, or at least his fights for the interim WBA World Junior Middleweight title. His record, 17 wins, 11 come up by knockout. He's got a loss and a couple of draws. Two of his draws were both questionable. Carlos Molina and Vanis Martacian, both pretty questionable, in my opinion. I think he should have lost the one, and I think he should have won the other one. Paul Williams, that majority decision loss, no disrespect to Paul, especially in lieu of what he's going through now. But Ursandi Lara won that fight, in my opinion, and didn't get the decision. Who's going to win this one? Tough call, but I think skills, I'm gonna coin a phrase, skills pay the bills. Now, I'm going to rip a line off of my man Floyd Mayweather Jr. Skills do pay the bills. I think that Ursandi Lara is more skilled than Alfredo Angulo. I'm picking Lara. In a fight that I can't wait to happen, Josito Lopez against Marcos Maidana. Josito Lopez, former world title challenger. He's got a record of 30 wins, 18 come by knockout, 5 losses, only 1 stoppage. He's a welterweight ranked number 12 already in the welterweight division. He should actually be fighting in a junior welterweight division. He's 28 years old, 69-inch reach, 5'9.5", 200 rounds as a pro with a 50% knockout ratio. His last fight, he had no business fighting Saul Canelo Alvarez at junior middleweight. That was ridiculous. They should have never fed him to the guy. His win over Victor Ortiz was great. The Jesse Vargas fight was pretty questionable. The win over Mike Dallas Jr., great. I love this kid. Anthony Mora, win over him. Patrick Lopez, which was a tough fighter. What a war that was. I mean, listen, if you don't like Josito Lopez, I know Given Quality is a guy that swears by the sweet science, but even he's got to like watching Josito Lopez. He takes on Marcos Maidana. He's a former world junior welterweight champ. 33 wins, 30 coming by knockout, 3 losses, never been stopped. Tough SOB, ranked number 14 in the world by the computer as a welterweight. Don't understand how. I don't think he's looked that good at welterweight. 29 years old, 69-inch reach, 5'7", 151 rounds as a pro with an 83% knockout ratio. He's fought all the best. Look at the lineups that he's fought since 2009. He fought Andre Kotalnik, Victor Ortiz, William Gonzalez, who's an absolute nightmare to fight, Victor Cayo, Demarcus Chop Chop Corley, Amir Khan, Eric Morales, Petra Petrov, Devon Alexander, Jesus Soto Carras, and Angel Martinez when he fought his last welterweight fight. Listen, I didn't know. He claimed that he had a hard time making the weight. That's why he moved up to welterweight. To tell you the truth, I think he lost his power as a welterweight, even though his last fight was a knockout. He's a wild fighter. He doesn't have the sweet science, so to speak. I actually think Josito Lopez has more sweet science skill, as we call it, than Marcos Maidana. I think it's going to be the most entertaining fight of the weekend. And I'm leaning to my boy, man. I'm one of the most loyal guys on the planet. I would never go against Josito Lopez, especially in this one. I'm picking Josito Lopez in an upset. The next one, Yorikas Gamboa against Darly Perez. Gamboa, this is, I think he's being considered as a super featherweight champion or an interim champ. I've lost track. He's undefeated, 22-0 with 16 knockouts. He's ranked number 1 in the world at super featherweight, 31 years old, 5'5.5", 65-inch reach, 109 rounds as a pro with a 73% knockout ratio. Listen, what can we say about this guy? I love him. I know he's been down, but he's never been hurt. He's got hand speed. He's just, the guy is, you know, the toughest thing he's had to go through since a fighter was swimming over here from Cuba on a coconut raft. I mean, let's be real. He takes on Darly Perez. young up-and-coming fighter, 28-0, 19 knockouts. He's the bigger fighter, ranked number 39 in the lightweight division. This fight will be contested at lightweight. 29 years old, 5'7", 68.5-inch reach, 125 rounds of pro with a 68% knockout ratio. Listen, I like Darley Perez. He's a talented fighter, but this is a different class of fighter he's stepping in. I don't care that he's bigger. Gamboa. It's like real estate. Location. Gamboa. That's who I'm picking. The next fight, Chad Dawson against Adonis Stevenson. Adonis Stevenson, 20 wins, 17 coming by knockout. He's got one loss. He was stopped. That was a long time ago. He's ranked number 5 in the world at light heavyweight, but he's 35 years old. Remember that. Keep that in the back of your mind. 5'11", 79-inch reach. 79 rounds as a pro with an 81% knockout ratio. He's been on a tear lately. His last 7-8 fights have all come by way of knockout. His last one against the tough Darnell Boone. Listen, I like Adonis Stevenson. He's tough, but he's stepping in with a boxer that has some skills. He's 30 years old, Chad Dawson. He's the world light heavyweight champion. He's 31 wins, 17 coming by knockout. A couple of losses, only been stopped once. His last bunch of fights, Andre Ward, Bernard Hopkins twice, Andre Dacanu, Jean Pascal, Glenn Johnson, Antonio Tarver a couple of times, Glenn Johnson again. I mean, come on. He's fought the creme de la creme. As much as I would love Adonis Stevenson to knock him out, Chad Dawson is probably going to outbox him and win a boring fight. I'm picking Chad Dawson. The next fight, James DeGalley against Stefan Bosic. DeGalley, he's the WBC Silver Super Middleweight Champion, and he's got a record of 15 wins, 1 loss, 10 coming by knockout. He's ranked by the computer at number 11 in the world at Super Middleweight, 27 years old, 6'1.5" tall, 89 rounds of pro with a 63% knockout ratio. His last two fights, good ones, Sebastian Demures, second round knockout, and he won a 12-round decision to win the silver belt against Fuluncio Zuniga. He steps in with Stefan Bosic, former world title challenger. He's 38 years old. This is a big issue here. He's 38 years old, ranked number 49 in the computer, 26 wins, 17 come by knockout, 6 losses, stopped 3 times out of those 6 losses, 5'10.5", 175 rounds as a pro. It's not going to be close. James DeGalley is going to win this one. In a fight that I'm going to be ringside for, Jose Melendez going to get up against Nick Brinson. Melendez, 26 wins, 25 coming by knockout. 2 losses, stopped both times. 1 draw, number 48 in the world at junior middleweight. He's only 24 years old, man. You know, he's got 29 fights at 24 years old. 97 rounds as a pro with an 86% knockout ratio. His last 5 fights all coming by knockout against decent opposition. He steps in with Nick Brinson. Now, Nick Brinson, he's a tough guy, but he's never fought anybody too bad. I mean, listen, the New York State Athletic Commission let him fight a 17-12-1 guy for his New York State middleweight title, which he holds. He's got a record of 14 wins, 6 coming by knockout, 1 loss, and he was stopped. He's got a couple of draws. He's only 25. It's a good opportunity for him, but he's a last-minute sub. Not just sure what he's going to do. He's ranked at middleweight, so he's actually going to have to come down a little bit in this fight, I guess. 89 rounds of pro with a 35% knockout ratio. Who's going to win this one? I think Brinson is going to give him a fight early on, but in the long run, Melendez is going to come out on top. And finally, Friday night fights, John Molina going up against Andre Killimov. Killimov, he's undefeated, 15-0 with 8 knockouts. He's ranked number 53 in the world at lightweight. He's 30 years old. He's got 80 rounds of pro with a 53% knockout ratio, 5'9.5". You know, he fought most of his fights in Russia. He has fought 3 of his last, 4 of his last 5 fights in the U.S. He hasn't really fought anybody that good except for his last fight, Matias Esquivel Gomez, who, you know, was 29-1 and he won a technical decision over him. He takes on John Molina, who's been around a little bit, former world title challenger, 25-2, 20 of his wins coming by knockouts. He was stopped 1 of the 2 times. He's ranked number 9 in the world at lightweight. He, too, is 30 years old, 5'10.5" tall, 72-inch reach, 95 rounds as a pro with a 74% knockout ratio. His last fight was against a good fighter, Danny Williams, and he lost to Antonio DeMarco via a first-round knockout. He was blown out in that one. I think he got righted the ship against Danny Williams. This is going to be a tough one because I like Killimov. But I'm picking John Molina in this one. I just have a feeling that he's going to come out on top. So the fights I'm picking John Molina over Andre Kilimov, Jorge Melendez against Nick Brinson, James DeGalley against Stefan Bosic, Chad Dawson against Adonis Stevenson, Yuriorkis Gamboa against Darley Perez, Josito Lopez against Marcos Medina, Arslandi Lara against Alfredo Angulo, Juan Carlos Sanchez against Roberto Sosa, Jose Pedraza against Sergio Villanueva, Jonathan Vidal against Mario Munoz, Jesse Magalhães over Henry Maldonado, and Marco Captain Crunch Huck over Ola Afolobi. Good luck to everybody that's in the challenge. Those are my picks, and I'm sticking to them.
Wake up. It's time for the... Ooh.
It's too early
for a trivia question.
Question.
All righty then. Question is being resort and casino in Verona, New York, and their fight that's taking place tomorrow night. I'll be ringside. If you haven't got tickets yet, try and get some right now, man. I'd love to see you there. You can get them by visiting our website, www.billycboxing.com. Click the fight poster. It's right on the right-hand side. Top, click it, buy yourself some tickets, write me an email, tell me where you're going to sit, and I'll do my bestest to find out where you are and say hello. So check that out. Remember, Turning Stone in Verona, New York. Today's It's Too Early for a Trivia Question question. The question is being supplied to us by our very own trivia question guru, Henry Askop, who, by the way, corrected me. He said that Elmer Ray was in the top 10 for that length of time, not number one. He was in the top 10 for that length of time. He did make it to number one, but not for all those months. So I just want to correct myself. The question is, who fought unsuccessfully for world titles in two different decades before finally winning a world title in a third decade? If you know that answer, email me billy@talkinboxing. That's talkinboxing.com. And if you're the first one to get it right, you're going to win the prize. And even if you're watching a replay of this show and you know the answer, email me, because nobody's got it right. We've had it all week, man. I want to give stuff away. So make sure you win it. So who fought unsuccessfully for world titles in two different decades before finally winning a world title in a third decade? If you know that answer, email me, billy@talkinboxing. That's talkinboxing.com.
This day in boxing history.
And finally, this day in boxing history is being brought to us by Ken Bonero and Tomkovich, if you're looking for a lawyer. Problem 845-221-4099. On this day, June 6, 1985, Alfonso Ratcliffe wins a 12-round decision over Carlos De Leon to win the WBC World Cruiserweight title. That took place on this day, June 6th, 1985, in Las Vegas. Also, on this day, June 6th, in 1988, Iran the Blade Barkley, who's going to be, as a matter of fact, I got a call today. He's on his way. He should be in Canastota right now. Iran the Blade Barkley knocks out Tommy Hearns in the third round to win the WBC World Middleweight title. And that took place on this day, June 6th, in 1988 in Las Vegas. And finally, on this day, June 6th, in 1912, Jim Driscoll knocks out Jean Posey in the 12th round to win the, now listen to this, he won the vacant British world featherweight title, because they had a world title back then, at least this was the vacant one, in London on this day in 1912. Jim Driscoll wins the vacant British world featherweight title. Hey man, that concludes our show for today. You know what I like to say, enjoy yourself this weekend if you go up to the International Boxing Hall of Fame, and I'd really like to see you at the Turning Stone in Verona, New York. But I do have one more thing to say. Make sure you tune in tomorrow evening. Same bat time, same bat channel. Love to have you there. Thanks for joining us tonight. We look forward to you next time. And don't forget, all next week, We got the new shows all airing 7:30 to 8:30. Check them out on LDLTV.com. See you all then. Ciao, baby.
Billy C, you don't call anymore. You don't stalk me. I mean, I appreciate the occasional shout out, but I lie in my bed shouting your name out all the time. Nothing. I don't know what happened. We were so close. And everybody likes to watch Billy C talking about boxing on LDLTV, but you don't give me the love you used to. I need more shout outs, Billy C, man. Give me some freaking love. Get myself all worked up just thinking about you and that mustache. It's delicious. You're watching Talking Boxing with Billy C and his mighty mustache on LDLTV.
Hi, I'm Olden Pawnee's former NBA player, and you're watching Talking Boxing on LDLTV with my man, Billy C.
My name is Tonton Bisha. You and me, we're watching now Talking Boxing with Billy C on your favorite TV, LDLTV. Yeah.